morning. If you're joining us for the first time, we have connection cards in the pews. If you're joining us online for the first time, there is an e-connection card. You can go onto our church website and fill that out. For some reason, I keep coming in and out.
I'll just keep going. I have a couple announcements this morning. This Wednesday night, we're having trunk or treat for the kids. That starts at 6:30. If you'd like to help out, we can always use some more help. Also, this coming Saturday, the Properties Committee is hosting a work day. That's from 8 a.m. to 12 p.m. They're going to meet in the back parking lot, and I'm sure they would love to have any help that they can get. Other than that, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Dear Lord, just thank you for letting us gather here this morning, Lord. Lord, please just help us during this hour just to worship you, Lord. Lord, you are just glorious, Lord, and you are worthy to be praised. Lord, I just pray that as Danny gives the message, Lord, that your word would speak to our hearts, Lord. Lord, may we grow to love you more, and may we grow to love others more. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, online. So good to see everyone here this morning. We're going to begin our worship service this morning with a song that we really learned in the park, and we brought it back in, called Waymaker, and it just tells us all the wonderful things about God. Would you please stand?
Never stop, you never stop working, never stop,
You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Amen. I'm going to let you take a few minutes and fellowship together. If you have a preschooler, you can go out over here with Miss Peggy, and then we will sing again.
Churches to share the gospel along with the collection, processing, and shipping of the And don't forget to activate Illegals so you can follow your box and discover its final destination.
Finally, make sure to check the website for the closest drop-off location near you.
Make sure to mark the date for the third week in November as National Collection Week.
Well, there you go. You just packed yourself a shoebox. Grandma.
Already done.
What? How? I thought she wasn't going to stores right now.
She isn't. She packed the box online.
That's right, Dad. With just a few clicks of a mouse, Grandma packed her whole shoebox online. She can choose from all kinds of gifts, even make a personal bag for her and a photo.
Wow. So she doesn't even need to leave the house?
Nope. She can stay safe inside and still have time for new friends.
Like
like to serve in that. Drop-off week is November 15th through the 22nd, and we'll be open 2 hours every day during that week, some mornings, some nights. You can come and fellowship and serve with Josephine's my counter partner. She helps me every day with that event. So, and if you do decide to pack boxes, on November 14th, we are having a dedication Sunday to the boxes. So you can bring your boxes and have them here on stage, and Dean's going to pray over them for us. And I do, if you have internet and you can go to the website, I encourage you to go. There's so many videos on there. It's hard to pick out a great video. I thought that one was pretty good. And I didn't share, this is the little booklet of how they disciple to the kids, The Greatest Journey. They have this in different languages, and they're able to go into these countries and provide the gospel, and that's how they're bringing children to Christ. And then these kids are going home and sharing Christ with their families, and then becoming little missionaries in their villages. It's just a wonderful, wonderful mission. So if you'd like to serve, just see me after church, or get the information out of the newsletter, or call the office, and I will put you to work. Thank you.
Having had the opportunity to listen to a few people over the last several years that were recipients of a box at one time, I can tell you that it does make a difference. One of the things I like most is not the gifts, it's the discipleship that happens. That these kids aren't just receiving some goodies, they're receiving the word of Christ, they're receiving the gospel, and that is great news. So continue to pray about Operation Christmas Child, maybe what your part in that would be. We're going to enter into our time of prayer. Let me just remind you of a few that are on our prayer list this morning. First of all, Teresa Garrett's father passed away late Thursday night, early Friday morning. Visitation is this afternoon, and then funeral service tomorrow. So continue to remember Teresa, as well as her husband Frank. Frank recently had some areas removed that were that the doctor said that looks a little suspicious. So some skin that was removed from his head that they're looking at. So Frank's healing from that as well. Also, want to remember the Fridley family. Bobby Fridley's service was this past Monday, and they were here this morning. It was good to see them, but continue to lift them up, as well as a number of folks who are still dealing with COVID or the effects or after effects of COVID. Charlie Reed with his itching, still want to continue to remember him. We've been in this sermon series about getting focused as a result of distractions around us, and I know it can be easy to watch the news and just get distracted, but we also need to be praying for these missionaries that were kidnapped in Haiti recently, and pray for a safe return for them as well, and be lifting them up. Don Ditzler is our person of prayer for this week. Don was in the first service, and his wife Susan is on our list. Susan had a severe asthma attack this past week, and has been to the doctor a couple of times trying to get that under control, and so I know they would appreciate your prayers, Don, especially as he's helping her out right now. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. God, we come before you, thanking you for the many attributes, the many ways in which we experience you. We thank you for your mercy, your grace, your compassion, your love, your care for us. Father, we thank you that you are sustaining. Father, that you are with us always, that you never leave us. Father, there are so many other ways in which we experience you, Lord. We give you thanks. We give you thanks that we can come personally and boldly to the throne room anytime we want, not just this morning. But we can approach you as a child approaching their father, ask for an audience with the creator of the universe. And Father, how humbling that is. And Lord, we come before you this morning lifting these folks up, many who have lost loved ones recently. We, of course, think of the Fridleys. We think of Jordan and Justin, who lost their twins recently, and continue to pray for them. We think of Teresa Garrett as they are today and tomorrow going through the process of celebrating her dad's life. And Father, Father, we pray for comfort. You promised the spirit of comfort through your Holy Spirit, so we pray that over them. Father, for many who are still experiencing COVID effects of or after effects, Father, I think high and isolated, still in the hospital, been in there so long now, Father, with scar tissue in his lungs, and Lord, lift him up and others who we know. Many folks here have friends or family that are going through COVID right now as well. Lord, we pray for healing in their bodies, for restoration of breathing. Father, thinking of breathing makes me think of Susan Ditzler and this recent asthma attack. So we lift her up to you as well. Father, be with Don as he's our person of prayer for this week. They've only been here a short time, but Father, they plug right in and are helping missionally in a variety of ways and are just immersing themselves into the life of this body. And so we lift them up to you this week. Father, for so many others that are on our list that need just a special touch from you. Lord, I think of these missionaries in Haiti, and Lord, I'm sure they're anxious and fearful in a variety of things. Father, I pray that you would just reveal yourself in supernatural, phenomenal ways right now to them, that you would be with them, that they would know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're with them right now. And Father, we do pray for a safe return to their family and to their friends. Lord, be with us as we continue to worship this morning. Open our hearts to be receptive to what your Spirit would show us and share with us. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
God is our help in time of trouble.
of you here, as well as those of you online. Thanks for worshiping with us this morning. Let me invite you all to take your Bibles. First of all, open them up to Luke chapter 10. And what I'm going to encourage you to do is stick a bulletin, a finger, stick something right there in that spot in Luke chapter 10, and then flip back over to Mark chapter 12. So Luke 10 and Mark 12. We've been looking at distractions because there is so much going on in the world around us right now. There are so many things that can distract us, get us off track from what we ought to be doing personally as Christ followers, as well as what we ought to be doing as the church together. And 2 weeks ago, we began this journey, this sermon series, to get focused. Author Stephen Covey, in his book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, said the main thing is to keep the main thing, and so we're focusing on the main thing. What are some of the main things that Scripture has to tell us that as Christ followers we ought to be focused on in today's society rather than allowing ourselves to get distracted from what we ought to be doing? The first week we saw that the main thing is that we're supposed to be making disciples as we go through our daily routines. We looked at that passage out of Matthew, the Great Commission, where Jesus said, go and make disciples. And we talked about what does that mean for us to go and to make disciples. Last week, we looked at this passage in Mark chapter 12, where Jesus said to love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, and with all of our strength. So let's pick it up and look at that again, because we're picking up a second part of this passage today and then a third part next Sunday. This is what it says beginning in verse 28. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, of all the commandments, which one is the most important? The most important one, answered Jesus, is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Well said, teacher, the man replied. You are right in saying that God is one, and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And from then on, no one dared to ask him any questions. Well, when it comes to our heart, we looked last week, we can talk about loving God all we want, but our heart exposes our true feelings. When we give our hearts completely to God, it sets us on a course to love him with all of our heart, to keep us from being distracted, to keep us focused on the things that we ought to be focused on in our lives. When Jesus tells us to love God with all our soul, he's referring to that control center of our lives. Those who love God with all their soul commit all of their energy to him and their decisions and their opinions and the things that control them. And in order to love God with all our mind, we need to spend our time studying God's word rather than worrying so much about philosophies and theories that are being peddled in today's society. If we focus on loving God with all of our mind, if we stay in his word, using it as our book, we can spot fake stuff as soon as we hear it, because we know what the real thing is and what it says. Our strength, to love God with our strength, is just what it sounds like. It's our physical capacities, including our possessions. And too often we give ourselves to so many of the distractions in life. We give a piece of ourselves to all of these things, and then at the end of the day, it seems like we have nothing left for God. No strength, no nothing left for him. Well, God didn't die for part of us. He doesn't save only certain parts of us. So why would we give only certain parts of ourselves back to him? We are called to love him with all that we have. So that's what it looks like to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. But then Jesus said, the second commandment is this: love your neighbor as yourself. They're both important, he said. And so this morning we're going to look at what does it look like to love our neighbor as ourselves, and what better passage to look at for that than the story of the Good Samaritan and found in Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 25. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" Jesus replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You've answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you'll live." There's your answer. But he wanted to justify himself. It's never good for us to try to do something God does for us. God is the one who justifies us, so in order, it's probably not a good thing to try to justify ourselves, but he does. He says, trying to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine. Then he put the man on his donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expenses you may have.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." In this passage, a lawyer comes to Jesus. He asks a simple question, a question that all of us would love an answer to. What must I do to inherit eternal life? He knew the Old Testament suggests this eternal inheritance that would one day be theirs as the Israelite nation. And so I'm guessing the lawyer was thinking, "Hey, how do I get my piece of this eternal pie? How can I make sure I'm included in that will when all is said and done? When these future blessings come, I want in on them." And the question that the lawyer asks is a good question, but it was asked with really poor intentions. Because we see, he asked the question as a way of trying to test Jesus, as a way of trying to trap him. And Jesus knew his motive. Jesus knows our hearts, our intentions. Jesus knew that. So he responds with a question of his own. He looks at the lawyer and he says, "Well, what's written in the law? How do you interpret what's written there?" The lawyer responds to Jesus with the same scripture that Jesus used when he was asked that question back in Mark. He quoted the Shema, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. "All good Jewish families, morning and evening, recite this even today. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength." And he added Leviticus 19, 18. Because these two combined give us what we call the Great Commandment. Jesus, these are important. And so he tells the lawyer, he's spot on. That's it. That's the right answer. If you do that, you'll live. Well, it wasn't enough for the lawyer. He wasn't satisfied with Jesus' response. He wanted to justify himself. And so what did he say? He asked a follow-up question, verse 29. "Well, okay. Love my neighbor as myself. That's all fine. Who's my neighbor?" You gotta love lawyers. You do gotta love them. Lawyers are used to litigating. Lawyers are used to debating. Lawyers are used to questioning. And so the lawyer says, look, define who my neighbor is. I mean, tell me, because I need to know so that I can justify myself. I need to know if I'm doing the right thing with the right people. Because internal inheritance is at stake here. So define your terms so that I can fulfill those terms. I'm guessing that this man, he was a lawyer, he was well versed. He probably understood what it says in Sirach. Sirach is a Jewish wisdom book. If you have a Bible that has the Apocrypha in it, Sirach is one of those books in the Apocrypha. It's some wisdom literature that didn't make the final cut, if you would. But this is what it says in Sirach chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. If you do good, know to whom you do it, and you will be thanked for your good deeds. Do good to the devout, and you will be repaid. If not by them, certainly by the Most High. No good comes to one who persists in evil, or to one who does not give alms. And then in verse 4, I wonder, how did this make it in there? Give to the devout, but do not help the sinner. The lawyer would have known that. It was Jewish wisdom literature. So he's asking, who's my neighbor? And what do I have to do in order to fulfill the law? Because, see, the lawyer was arguing that some people are neighbors and others are not. Some people are worthy of my help and some people are not worthy of my help. Really, as a good Jew, the only person I'm responsible for are other Jews. And so he's questioning Jesus. His suggestion makes it sound like some people aren't neighbors. And so Jesus responds with a story. Now, in other places, and in your Bible, if you've got headings in your Bible, it may even call this the parable of the Good Samaritan, but it's not a parable. In most other places, Jesus says, let me share a parable. Or Scripture says he shared a parable with them. This is a story. This is probably something that happened. It may have been in the news. People may have been very familiar with what Jesus is saying right here. It may have been like Haitians or missionaries that were kidnapped in Haiti. We know about this. It spread. Those hearing this story would have been really familiar with the road going from Jerusalem to Jericho. It was a 17-mile stretch of road that was dangerous. I mean, this isn't the first guy that's ever been robbed on this road. The road was lined with caves, and so it was not uncommon for robbers to hide out in the caves to jump people when they walked by. And Jesus says a man traveling was stripped, beaten, robbed, and left for dead on the side of the road. Thankfully, those who helped came along. Can you imagine the Samaritan, eyes kind of bruised, maybe able to peek through, and he's laying there naked, and just kind of, and as he sees, oh man, here comes help, somebody's coming. And Jesus says, a priest showed up, and then a Levite. Both of these were righteous men. Both of these were men that the lawyer could have identified with. Religion, they were good church people, y'all. And Jesus says, the Levite and the priest passed by intentionally on the other side and avoided helping the man out. Next comes, though, more help. But wait a minute. The Samaritan. And this would have caused every Jew listening to have gone on edge, to have gone on guard. This would be like me saying a UVA med student stopped to help a Virginia Tech veterinary student.
Oh, no, they wouldn't do that. You're making somebody from UVA. Some of y'all just went,
That would have been the response to this lawyer. It would have been the response to every Jewish person standing there. A Samaritan came by, Jesus said, somebody who is unworthy, a half-breed, somebody that we don't like, they don't belong here. But look at everything he did for the man in need. He goes to him rather than avoiding him. He puts bandages on the man. He pours oil and wine on his wounds. He puts him on his donkey. He takes him to an inn. He cares for him. He gets up the next morning and pays the innkeeper for 2 weeks, says, listen, I want you to take care of him. Make sure he gets better. And by the way, when I come back through, if this doesn't cover it, keep a tab, and I'll pay the difference on my next trip through. On top of all of this, the Jewish people would have just been furious at this moment. Because Jesus finishes the story, and he turns to the lawyer, and he says, now, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robber? And the lawyer hated Samaritans so much, he couldn't even say the name Samaritan. He simply responds with, well, the one who showed mercy. And so Jesus tells him what? Go and do likewise. We saw this word go a couple of weeks ago. Remember in the Great Commission, Jesus said, go and make disciples. And we learned that that word go wasn't just go to Africa, go to the Dominican, go to Alaska, go to. It means as you go through your daily life, make disciples. And we looked at how we can do that in our lives. Well, now Jesus is saying, go. So as you go, show mercy and meet people's needs. Go and do likewise. As you go, do what the Samaritan did. As I looked at this story, as I wrestled with it myself, as I tried to keep the main thing for my own life, here's some things that I thought about, some takeaways for me. The first is, as you go, don't make excuses. I think I'm good at that. Maybe you are too on occasion. We can probably think of excuses why the priest and the Levite intentionally went to the other side of the road, because we know how to make excuses. And look, helping others can be messy. And for the priest and the Levite, they didn't want to become unclean by touching that. It may have been dead already. We have laws about cleanliness. At times in my life, I've looked at a situation and gone, ooh, that's a mess. I just don't want to involve myself. I don't want to get in the middle of that mess right now. Or we use the not my fault. Not my fault he got attacked on the side of the road. He's the dummy that was traveling alone to begin with. Yeah, if you've been traveling with somebody, maybe this wouldn't happen. It's not my fault. It's not my fault you don't have a job. There's plenty of jobs available. Just go get one. Not my fault. Or we look at it and we go, man, the Levite and the priest, I mean, come on, these are godly men, so maybe they were just wore out from helping others. Let's give them a break. I mean, maybe they've been serving at the temple all week, and now they're on their way home, and they're just exhausted, you know? I mean, I've been there. I've gone home, and I've been like, oh, God, really? You want me to go do this now? I'm tired, man. I need time with my family. I haven't been with my family all week, and now you're, oh, man. So we make excuses. What if? You know, God, I'd help. I really would, but what if the bandits are waiting? They're using this guy's bait, and they're going to jump me next. I mean, come on, I can't get involved. I don't want to be the next victim. Or, wow, it's a busy intersection that you're holding that sign at. There's a lot of traffic. Somebody will help. Somebody's coming. Somebody will take care of this. The priest left it to the Levite. The Levite did what the priest did. Nothing. We tend to make excuses, or at best we're like the lawyer, and we want to know, okay, if I help out, just exactly what's required of me before I jump in. What all am I going to have to do? I want to do what's necessary. I don't want to do too much, so help me just on what, how much. I mean, it's easy to look around. There's a lot of pain, a lot of suffering going on in the world around us right now. A lot of struggles happening, and so we wonder, what can I do? I mean, there's just so much that needs to be done. It can be a daunting task to even think about, what kind of difference can I make? There's so much that needs to be done. Well, a better approach would simply be to lend a hand where you can. Maybe you can't help everyone, but you can help someone. You can do something. You may remember Brittany Garten when she was here back in August. She shared a story that she had heard about a starfish on the beach when she was a teenager, and it motivated her to become a missionary in Romania. And maybe you've heard the story, you remember it from Brittany, but the story goes that the tide had gone out, and when it went out, it left thousands of starfish up and down the beach. And the little boy saw the starfish and knew that the sun would dry them up if they weren't in the water. And so he begins picking them up one at a time and chucking them back into the ocean, and he's doing all that he can, and an adult comes along. It's always an adult that messes up. An adult comes along. Boy, what are you doing? He says, I'm saving starfish. The adult said, son, look at this beach. There are thousands of starfish right here. This beach is miles long. You can't save them all. And he picked up one and chucked it back in the ocean. He said, but I can save that one. And this one. And that. We can do something. And so what is God calling you to do? Make a difference instead of making excuses. You may not be able to do everything, but you can do something. So quit doing nothing. Is what Jesus is saying. Okay, well. So what else? Jesus said, as you go, show mercy. We're going to be coming back to this one next week because it goes along with the third part of that Mark passage that we're going to be looking at. But let me say this. When it comes to loving our neighbor as ourselves, it doesn't mean that we never point out the sin in their life. What it does mean is this. We don't begin with the sin. We begin by journeying with them, by helping them through the situation that they find themselves in. We build trust. We build a relationship. And there comes a point where now they trust us enough where we can have that kind of conversation with them. But the whole pointing out the sin is a whole other sermon coming up in a few weeks, so hold on to that one too. Y'all got to keep coming back. I'm just making it. Show mercy and compassion. Build that relationship. It's easy for us to talk about abstract principles with never solving a concrete problem. I mean, we can talk about hunger all day long and never feed a hungry family. By the way, don't forget that we are collecting a hunger offering right now. We'll be harvesting these in a couple of weeks, and that's something you can do. You may not be able to solve the hunger problem in the world, but you can do something in that bread loaf or envelope or box. We can talk about job opportunities all we want. Look, there should be nobody unemployed right now. Everybody's hiring. There's a job for everybody. Just get off your lazy hindquarters and go to work. Have you ever stopped to talk to somebody without a job and find out why they're not working? Maybe they don't have transportation. Oh, so maybe if I helped you with transportation, then you could work? Yeah, that's all I need. Shoot, I can do that. But we just jump to conclusions. We make assumptions without getting to know people and seeing what we can do. The lawyer wanted to discuss the meaning of neighbor. Who's my neighbor? He was looking at it in broad strokes. Jesus is not a broad strokes person. And so he helps him look at one concrete example to get the man thinking. The question is not, who is my neighbor? See, that's the wrong question to be asking.
Jesus is saying this, you need to be asking, who can you be a neighbor to? By reversing our perspective, Jesus changes both the question and the answer. It's not about judging someone else. It's not about us being a certain kind of person to somebody else. It's about doing what we can because of our love for God. By using the Samaritan as the hero in the story, Jesus is showing us that neighbors show up in surprising and unusual places. It's not about who is my neighbor. It's about how can I be a neighbor to the people who I encounter. Who can I be a neighbor to as I go through my daily life? Being a neighbor has nothing to do with geography. It has nothing to do with nationality, nothing to do with citizenship, nothing to do with which team you root for and which team they root for. It has everything to do with how can I meet somebody else's needs. We're to respond to others with love because we have received love when we entered into a relationship with God. We love because God first loved us. As a result of the love we receive, we want to love others. Wherever people need us is where we can be a neighbor. We can be a neighbor as we keep our eyes and ears open and respond out of a compassionate heart. Jesus said the Samaritan saw the man and took pity on him. The ESV translation and some others say, when the Samaritan saw the man, he had compassion for him. A compassionate heart sees and feels and serves. The major difference between the priest and the Levite compared to the Samaritan isn't about what they saw and heard, it's how they responded to what they saw and heard. The Samaritan is the one with a compassionate heart. He did what he could to minister to the man's needs. There are all kinds of things we can do. I got to think about, okay, so when it comes to being distracted individually, when it comes to being distracted as a church, what's the main thing? What's the main thing? If I'm going to keep the main thing, And I began to think about, what are some things individually that we can do? Well, some of y'all do all the time, but maybe you're just not realizing it. We can volunteer. We can volunteer at ministries like Solomon's Mission or the Rescue Mission. We can give to a hunger offering individually. In our family group me thread yesterday, my daughter-in-law in Connecticut put on the family thread, hey, can we as a family do the drumstick dash on Thanksgiving Day? Can we do something? Well, yeah, we can, as a matter of fact. We can move our feet so others can eat, as the saying goes. We can give food to someone in need. We can help take care of someone who is hurting physically, emotionally, or whatever. We can open our homes. I've been challenged on this one recently, y'all. One of my sons and daughter-in-law and their kids live in a three-bedroom, one-bath, modest ranch. Small, probably, I'm guessing, just over 1,000 square feet. And their basement's unfinished. So they got to thinking about Afghan refugees, and they got to talking to an inner-city ministry and said, hey, you know, we can't do much, but we've got a basement. And my son said, I'm even willing to finish part of the basement off. You know, is there a need? And the person in this ministry said, well, yeah, but can I tell you there's a family who I think would really could use you all right now? It's a single mom with three kids who's going through a tough spot. She doesn't have a home, place to live. And so my son finished off a portion of his basement. And now mom, three kids, and my son and my daughter-in-law and their kids are sharing one bathroom upstairs. But my son said, Dad, can you help? I'm going to put it in the bathroom right here. And I'm like, sure, I can help. And then Debbie and I look at our house and go, oh, guess we ought to be doing something, shouldn't we? And open your home. If you're a school-age person here, there's somebody in your school that could use a half peanut butter sandwich. There's somebody in your school that could use a listening ear. There's somebody in your school that could use a friend. There's always something that we can do if we're just willing to look with our eyes and listen with our ears and allow God to speak through our heart. There's a variety of things that we can do individually. In Matthew 25, Jesus said, when we give to someone in need, when we give
something to eat or drink, clothes to wear, when we invite them in, when we help them when they're sick or visit them in prison, it's as if we're doing it unto Jesus. So what can I do? I need to quit making excuses about what I can't do and begin to look at how can I help personally. For 23 years, I served another church nearby. And I always heard about things that Mill Creek Baptist was doing. And I was the staff representative to that church's mission committee. And trying to justify myself, I always thought, there's no way. There's no way that a church the size of Mill Creek does all of that. Made me feel better. Until I became your pastor. I went, man. A church the size of Mill Creek does all that. And then some. There's stuff we can be doing individually, and there's stuff we can be doing as a church to keep from being distracted. I had two separate conversations yesterday. I was at the Upward football game. Two different conversations didn't even happen near one another. But this one gentleman who I was talking with is a Bottle Top County School employee. He said, man, would you thank your church for the note card with the sweet treats that we got. And just knowing that people are praying for us makes a huge difference. I kept that note, he said, I kept that note with the three pieces of candy attached right at my desk, and there came time where I needed some encouragement, so I would take a piece of candy and read the note and eat the candy. He said, I'm out of candy now. I said, it's Mill Creek, you're bound to be getting more soon. Went about 30 minutes or so later, had another conversation. This woman said, would you please thank the church for the prayer blanket? And not just for the prayer blanket, but for the cards. People at the church continue to send us cards. We don't go to your church. We got one the other day. Looked like fingerprints. And I said, yeah, it was. It was thumbprints. Did it say, somebody loves you? Yes. I said, yeah, small kids put those together. I said, we'll just teach them to be missional. There's something we can do. Our backpack ministry here at the church helps meet hunger needs for over a dozen families from Buckhannon Elementary every Friday. Food goes home with the family. Our woodcutting ministry provides firewood for several needy families in our community who can only afford to heat their home with wood. Our Greater Outdoor Ministry helped the disabled sportsmen hunt the fishing rodeo. I love those. It is so much fun to watch disabled hunters get to hunt. It's so much fun to watch children catch fish. To hear about a family, where were they from, Judy?
Nepal.
Nepal. A Nepalese family was at the fishing rodeo. And they were like, we get to keep these? Trout in Nepal are a delicacy that we couldn't afford. And you're telling us we had to take these home? Some of us went 2 days later, fished that pond out, and made sure that Nepal family got all the trout they could eat for a year, I think. We continue to support Operation Christmas Child and send Christmas packages to the mission in Philadelphia. The Dominican Republic team, although they couldn't go, they sent money to help keep the preschool in operation there, even help repair a roof on a house there from a recent storm that went through. The Alaska team helped support the ministry that Brenda Krim is doing in Alaska Missions. Our many and mighty Mill Creek Explorers with some adults went to the Royal Apartments and did two mission trips this past year where they just handed out goodies and invited people to come to church. Some of our youth participated in Impact Virginia Mission Project here in Roanoke this past summer. They helped a woman in Roanoke with some home needs, some physical needs on her home that she couldn't do. A group of teenagers from Mill Creek Baptist took care of that for her. Our Vacation Bible School and our church collected money to purchase mosquito nets that are going to be sent to sub-Saharan Africa to help alleviate the spread of malaria in that place. Kids who brought offering to VBS, you all who helped give to that, are doing something. We collected hygiene kits and school supplies for Standing Rock Indian Reservation. Then we collected more hygiene kits for refugees and for disaster relief. And you all just keep bringing and keep giving because we can do something.
I took a load to the BGAV a couple of weeks ago in Richmond and got to talk to them and hear some of the stories. We received a note from the BGAV this past week thanking us for our efforts in that. And refugees who are arriving from Afghanistan are finding hope through a simple Ziploc bag with hygiene products in it. Loving your neighbor as yourself depends on your outlook. To the thieves, the man traveling was a victim to you, so they attacked him and got what they could from him. To the priest and the Levite, the man was an annoyance to avoid, so that's what they did. To the Samaritan, he was a neighbor to love and help, and so that's what he did. And notice, he didn't just bandage the man up and say, "Stinks to be you. Glad you're going to be okay. See you later." He took care of the man's needs from the beginning through the healing process. He didn't just throw a bone. What Jesus said to the lawyer, he says to us, "Go and keep doing likewise." Don't let the world distract you and tell you that these people aren't yours. They're not your concern. Don't let the world distract you and keep you from doing something when you can do anything to help. Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." And the second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this. What's the main thing? As you go, love God by loving others and meeting their needs in His name. Don't worry about who your neighbor is. Worry about being a neighbor. God, we thank you for the opportunity we have in your name to meet the needs of others. Father, help us not to get caught up in everything we're doing and think it's enough. But Father, help us to continue to strive to do all that we can to meet other people's needs. Whatever that looks like, Father, place it on our hearts, put it within us. And then, Father, may we have the motivation by the Holy Spirit to follow you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Will, it begins with loving the Lord God with all your heart until you recognize that God loved you so much that He sent His Son to die on the cross for you. It's going to be hard to love Him. But once you recognize that, your desire ought to be, I want Him in my life. He's willing to do that for me. That's who I want to follow. And so if you've never invited Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, if you've never asked Him to forgive you of your sins, what's keeping you from doing that today? He would love to come in to cleanse you, Scripture says, from all your unrighteousness, from all the stuff you've done that's wrong and bad. He wants to come in and forgive you for all that, give you a fresh slate to start on. But it begins as you welcome Him, as you ask Him in your heart. If you're here and you'd like to know more about that, come on, I'll share it with you. If you're online, connect with me this week. I'd love to help you out with that. Maybe you're sitting here and the Holy Spirit started poking at you, saying, remember that opportunity that you missed? You missed that one, but trust me, I'm bringing another one your way. Maybe you already know what that is. Maybe you're sitting there going, the Lord's been telling me about this. So maybe you just need to, where you are, or here at the altar, or there at your house, you just need to stop and say, "Okay, Lord, forgive me for the ones I missed, and help me to focus on the ones you're going to bring my way, so that I can be the neighbor that you're calling me to be." Here at Mill Creek, we help hold one another accountable, individually as we serve, as well as collectively as the church. We want to do all we can to meet the needs of our neighbors, not just here in Fincastle, Buckhannon, and Trouble, but in Virginia, the U.S., the Dominican, and around the world. So if you want to become part of the Mill Creek family, you can do that by statement of faith. You can do that by transfer of letter. You can do that by baptism. But if you'd like to know more about what it means to be part of the Mill Creek family, I'd love to share that with you. But understand this, when you become part of the family, we're going to expect you to come on out with us to serve the neighbors around us. Maybe there's some other decision the Lord's placed on your heart this morning. You just need to take care of that before we leave this place. Whatever it is, we're going to have one more opportunity to worship, one more opportunity to sing. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Here am I, send me, Lord. If you do nothing else during this song, think about the words that you're singing and make that the prayer as you prepare to leave and head out into the world today. Let's stand and sing. If you have a decision to make, I'll be right here.
Father, help us not to look at the mess, but to look at the opportunity as we leave this place. An opportunity to serve others in your name because of the love that we have for you. We want to express it through the things that we do. So, Father, be with us this coming week. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Y'all have a blessed week.